Later, after college and marriage, she had been active in her congregation, had become president, then later president of our regional congregational body. She'd just been elected to the union's North American board. I obviously had become a rabbi and then president of the union. In about 10 seconds, we were exchanging stories about our summer at camp, the Jewish life and the Jewish studies, but also the gossip and the romances and the impact that it made on our lives. How many Jewish experiences do you have that you can remember with such enthusiasm and in such vivid detail 32 years after the fact? And how often does this happen? All the time. As I travel, I am constantly meeting people who are leaders in Reform Jewish life and who were together with me in camp, and many I don't know and I've never met, but who say, when I talk about these things, camp changed my life. I know people, some in their 50s, some in their 60s, some in their 70s, who have had extraordinary experiences in their lives, who've seen combat in the Israeli army, who have battled poverty in Africa, who've worked on Broadway or in Hollywood, and yet do not talk about these experiences with the same air of excitement, enthusiasm, and nostalgia that they talk about their days in a Jewish camp. A while back in Detroit, they did a survey of Jewish high school graduates, the communal high school, and they asked, what is your peak Jewish experience? For the unaffiliated kids — unaffiliated here means unaffiliated with any synagogue — the answer was none. For kids who attended a Jewish camp, in almost every case, the answer was Jewish camp. And what was their worst Jewish experience? Someone want to guess? Hebrew school. Hebrew school, and by this, I mean it's supplementary school. It's an essential element of Jewish survival. It teaches the fundamentals of Judaism and creates a connection between the child and the synagogue. I believe our religious schools are getting better all the time, and I'm going to have more to say about that later. But there is an inescapable reality. At a certain point, no matter how good it is, it becomes an imposition on a child's time, which is why the school needs to be supplemented by camp. Why the one other statistic. Every year I go to Jerusalem and I meet with the new students at HUC, rabbinic cantorial education, and I ask, how many of you have been to any Jewish camp, either one of ours or another's? It depends on the year, but the range is always 60% to 80%. 60% to 80%. We know where our leaders are coming from. And many of our lay leaders as well. Why the power of camp? That's a long answer. I don't have time for it in full today. And I'd refer you back to last year's talk at this event by Rabbi Ethan Tucker, who did really a brilliant analysis of what he called Jewish immersion experiences. But the short answer is this. Judaism is about many things: Torah and mitzvot, learning and prayer, chesed and social justice. But it's also about passion and about joy. And so often today, we fail to convey the passion and joy of Jewish life. But camps can create passion, because at camp you have a 24-hour-a-day Jewish culture. At camp you can educate the whole child. You can combine state-of-the-art recreation and sports with state-of-the-art informal education. Now, our camps are not utopias. They're not without their problems. I like to bring around with me when I talk about camping. This is a letter from my son, Adam, from when he was at Camp Harlem, the actual letter. Dear Mom and Dad, how are you? How's everything at home? I don't have that much more to tell you. Goes on. Down below. The homesick kid left this morning. Two kids were almost kicked out of camp from my bunk. They had to talk to Aryeh, the director, because they put together this device that was like a small pipe bomb. It wasn't that dangerous. We love receiving that. There is, I admit, something a little bizarre about Jewish camping. Its appeal is in some ways counterintuitive. Jewish kids, let's admit, more often than not, are spoiled kids. Their lives are filled with television, all manner of electronic gadgets that seem to be almost growing out of their bodies, junk food, and lots of freedom. To live a single day without a cell phone is unthinkable. And then they come to our camps, and they live without television, without telephones, without cell phones, at least, unless we catch them. And without computers, or at least with minimal access to computers. And they even eat three more or less nutritious meals a day, and they enjoy every minute of it. Again, camp is not a substitute for a school or a youth group or a synagogue, but neither do we have any substitute for our camps, because that's where our kids go to do Jewish, to stretch their Jewish muscles and to grow in wisdom and in knowledge. And it's the place where, more than anywhere else, it is fun to be Jewish. Now, what are the great challenges? And in all everything that I said, I know I am preaching to the choir. Peretz l'delet petucha, as they say in Hebrew. I don't have to convince you about any of those things. But what are the great challenges that we now face in the world of Jewish camping? There are three that I see, and I'd like to put them before you and ask that we deal with them together. Challenge number one. I don't think that camps have yet been elevated to the highest rung of Jewish communal priorities. Very significant progress has been made in this regard, due in large measure to the efforts of Harold, to Jerry Silverman, to others. There is today far more communal and philanthropic involvement in Jewish camping than there once was. And first-year camping incentives are provided by many federations, by some foundations. Nonetheless, in my view, camping still does not receive the support and the attention that other educational areas receive, and it is not approached with the urgency that its successes surely justify and that the times demand. In some communities and in some philanthropic venues, it remains a marginal concern, far less important than other things, for example, day schools and birthright. And I'm not suggesting, God forbid, more resources for Jewish camping and less for others. Our major educational endeavors in the Jewish community must be complementary and not competitive. And I strongly believe that a broad and inclusive educational vision will generate support for all of its components. My point is that the North American Jewish community does not yet fully understand that Jewish camping is one of the three or four foundational pillars of Jewish education and identity. That there are many children who, if they are to be drawn into Jewish life, will be drawn in by Jewish camps and nothing else. And that camping must be seen as a lodestar and not a stepchild of Jewish communal activity. Let's consider day schools. Day schools are a grand success, a vital part of our educational menu. My wife and I sent our two children to a conservative day school and paid, as we like to remember, don't like to remember, 23 years of day school tuition. Without a moment's regret. Our children, like many others, emerge from their day school experiences with an infinitely profounder knowledge of Judaism and Jewish texts than they could have ever attained in a supplementary school. They emerged as well with a level of Jewish self-assurance and a commitment to Israel and Jewish peoplehood that would have been impossible to achieve in any other educational setting. Nonetheless, we now see that certainly outside of the Orthodox community, our day schools have and will continue to have a certain limited reach. Among non-Orthodox Jews, for a variety of sociological reasons, there's a resistance to day school that remains, in some cases, strong. Very high costs will continue to be a serious obstacle, especially in difficult economic times.